the best. You can be the King Kong banging on your chest.
You can beat the world, you can beat the war. You can talk to God, go banging on his door.
You can throw your hands up, you can beat the clock.
Yeah.
You can move a mountain, you can break rocks.
You can be a master, don't wait for luck. Dedicate yourself and you go find yourself.
Standing in the hall. And the world's gonna know your name.
Welcome, ladies and gents, to an all-new episode of Hall of Heroes. I'm your host, CQ Round 7. Now, let's talk about Disney. You all know by now that I am an absolute fan of this animation company. It has given us tons and tons of movies and TV shows that we enjoy to this very day. And many of them come with heroes that we have grown to love, many of which I will be discussing about in the future. And one of these movies that we love to this very day is their 31st anime classic, Aladdin. Yeah, I'm sure most of us watch this movie all the time as kids, and can you really blame us? This movie would become so successful that it would eventually spawn two sequels, an animated television spin-off, and an upcoming live-action remake. The movie itself is well known for its great animation, memorable songs, and a wonderful cast of characters. And two of them are the focus of today's episode, the daring thief Aladdin and the beautiful princess Jasmine. I was originally considering to give these two their own videos, but I thought it would be better to talk about both of them here, since they surprisingly have a lot in common. Let's start things off by talking about the main protagonist himself, Aladdin, voiced by Full House star Scott Weininger. Aladdin was definitely an anomaly for Disney at the time, in that this is the first time that a prince would be the main protagonist. For the longest time, the prince would usually be either a background character or just some plot device that had very little to almost zero personality. Then Aladdin comes along, who doesn't start off as a prince, but as a thief living on the street stealing food. So Aladdin is a criminal, right? Well, not exactly. Aladdin may be a thief, but he's more along the lines of Jean Valjean in Les Miserables. He only steals what he and his monkey friend Abu need in order to survive. And living on the streets means Aladdin has to be quick on his feet and very smart, especially when it comes to outsmarting the guards who are constantly after him. And he even gets his own song on how awesome he is with his wits.
One jump ahead of the bread line, one swing ahead of the sword. I steal only what I can't afford. That's everything. One jump ahead of the lawmen. That's all, and that's no joke. These guys don't appreciate I'm pro.
But, despite being a thief, Aladdin does do good deeds for others, like how he gave those poor kids the loaf of bread that he and Abu risked their hide to steal, and also saves those exact kids from being whipped by Prince Ahmed.
I kill you!
No, not that Ahmed. This Ahmed.
I'll teach you some manners!
And let's not forget that he saved Jasmine from getting her hand chopped off. See, Aladdin doesn't need to get involved with some random girl he just met in the marketplace, but he does the heroic thing and comes to her aid. Then again, if you met someone who is as drop-dead gorgeous as Jasmine, can you really blame him? So he's got good looks, wit, and a heart of gold willing to help anyone in need. He's a hero that's both charming and flawless, right? Charming? Yes. Flawless? Not so much. Which isn't a bad thing. As I stated a while back in my review on Cool Cat Sees the Kids, having a character that is 100% perfect is one of the worst things you can possibly do. Thankfully, Aladdin isn't this. One of his big problems is that he is very insecure about being poor.
Someday, Abu, things are gonna change. We'll be rich, live in a palace, and never have any problems at all.
So, basically, Aladdin believes that all of his and Abu's problems would disappear if they had a lot of money and lived a life of luxury. And he is only partially right. Sure, they would have the money to buy food, better clothes, and healthier living arrangements, but as he finds out towards the end of the film, money is never going to buy him true happiness. This could very well explain why Aladdin was fooled so easily by the old man's promise of riches in the Cave of Wonders. He's blinded by the promise of gold and treasure and a chance with the princess. Considering how smart Aladdin usually is, you would think he would realize how suspicious this whole setup is. But then again, he is locked in a dungeon, so what other choice does he have at this point? When Aladdin does get a hold of the lamp, he releases the genie and gets his three wishes. So now all of his problems are solved, right? Nope, they are just the beginning. Since Aladdin doesn't feel secure in his own skin, his first wish is to become a prince with new clothes, treasure, and money. And yet, this new makeover only pushes Jasmine further away, since she preferred the simple, down-to-earth boy back at the marketplace and not this pompous prince. Can you sense the irony here? It only gets worse when Aladdin piles up more lies to Jasmine, digging him much deeper than he already is. He eventually freaks out over his situation and even snaps at Genie.
Everyone thinks I'm worth anything is because of you. What if they find out I'm not really a prince? What if Jasmine finds out? I'd lose her. Genie, I can't keep this up on my own. I can't wish you free.
Ouch, that's pretty harsh. Not only has Aladdin's lies hurt him, but also has cost the genie his freedom.
What an asshole!
In the end, Aladdin learns that the truth shall set you free. He defeats Jafar and saves Jasmine, the Sultan, and all of Agrabah. But his big hero moment is actually with Genie. Think about it. It's already been established that Aladdin, despite being a thief, did care for others and put their needs before his own. But here, he kicks it up a notch by setting the Genie free. This boy, who had nothing and was exposed to the possibility of having everything from a new home, food, and being with the love of his life, rejects all this to make his friend happy. And this is probably why Aladdin earns his happiness in the end. Not because he defeated Jafar or saved Agrabah, but for being himself. An honest and loyal young man who's more than worthy than any normal prince. Any diehard Aladdin fan would tell you that is not the end. A couple years after Aladdin's release, we would get the first Disney straight-to-video sequel, The Return of Jafar. Here, Aladdin is now engaged to Jasmine. I guess when the Sultan changed the law for a commoner to marry the princess, he also changed the whole married by 16th birthday to marry whenever ready. There really isn't much to say with this film regarding Aladdin. Iago returns in hopes to join Aladdin, Jafar returns for revenge, Aladdin and company finally defeat Jafar, all thanks to Iago, and Iago joins Aladdin and his family. Aladdin turns down the Sultan's offer of becoming his royal vizier, saying he wants to go off to see the world. And this would be a leeway to the television series. Here, Aladdin is still living on the streets of Agrabah and engaged to Jasmine. Throughout the series, he battles monsters, searches for treasure, and protecting the city from all sorts of danger. And with Jafar now dead, you can bet Aladdin and company have a whole load of new foes to deal with. From the wicked sorcerer Mosenrath and the evil witch Mirage, to the mad scientist Mechanicles and the lustful mermaid Selene. Aladdin serves as a more laid-back and loyal hero, but he can sometimes be very self-absorbed. This is best shown in the episode Getting the Bugs Out, where there was trouble several times, and he took all the credit for fighting off the threat, when it was Genie and Carpet who did all the work. In some episodes, we learn some of Aladdin's past. In the two-parter episode Seems Like Old Crimes, we learn that Abu originally worked for a corrupt group of circus performers. In The Lost Ones, Aladdin had a childhood friend named Amal who mysteriously vanished. Years after his disappearance, Aladdin finds out Amal was kidnapped and turned into a ferocious beast, thanks to the dark magic of Mirage. Aladdin does manage to save Amal, who leaves Agrabah to make something of himself. And finally, after 86 episodes of the TV series, we finally reach to Aladdin and the King of Thieves, the finale to the Aladdin franchise. Here, Aladdin and Jasmine finally get married. That is, until the end of the film. Before that, Aladdin finds his father, Kasim, who is the King of Thieves. What follows is Aladdin trying to rescue his father from the 40 Thieves, a treasure hunt for the Hand of Midas, and finally, the wedding. Took them long enough, don't you think? Which is actually surprising for Disney. Most of the time, a couple get married within a day or a couple days. But these two waited for over a year or two, for all we know. I think I have said what I can say about Aladdin. Now let's move along to Princess Jasmine, voiced by Linda Larkin. Much like how Aladdin started the trend for multi-personality princes, Jasmine was part of a trend in the Disney Renaissance of empowered Disney princesses. Much like with Ariel and Belle of before, Jasmine is confident, strong, and takes no for an answer. And being the Princess of Agrabah must be wonderful, right? Not really. While she may not be starving on the streets like Aladdin, she does have it just as rough. She has to marry a prince by her 16th birthday against her own free will, even if the prince turns out to be a jerk. Yeah, we're still going to hammer in the fact Jasmine's only 15 in this film. And considering that she could have ended up marrying this guy.
I've never been so insulted.
Ahmed, you're not leaving so soon, are you?
Good luck marrying her off.
Could have ended in some pretty uncomfortable territory here, Disney. And that's not all.
Never done a thing on my own. I've never had any real friends. Except you, Raja. I've never even been outside the palace walls.
But Jasmine, you're a princess.
Then maybe I don't want to be a princess anymore.
So not only does she have to marry at such a young age, but she also was never allowed to leave her home or make friends. I'm beginning to think this is less of a palace and more of a prison. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but wouldn't the princess be allowed to leave the palace to travel and walk around the city with some guards by her side? Unless she has long, delicate locks that heals the injured or ice powers that no one knows about, I honestly don't see why the Sultan would just keep her locked up all the time. This does lead Jasmine to run away from home. And running away proved to be a smart move, at least for a short time. Since she has never been outside the palace walls, she doesn't know how money works, and this almost leads to her getting her hand cut off.
America.
This is what happens when you don't teach your kids about the real world. However, there is one good thing about her running away. She meets Aladdin and ends up falling in love with him. He's someone she can trust, and at the time, Al doesn't know about her being the princess, so he doesn't have any agenda with her. He just likes her for her. And, much like Aladdin, she's also pretty smart and isn't so easily fooled by Al's disguise.
From the market. I knew it. Why did you lie to me?
Jasmine, I'm sorry.
Did you think I was stupid?
No.
That I wouldn't figure it out?
No, I hoped you wouldn't.
Honestly, did you really think, Al, you were going to fool her like that? Who do you think she is? Lois Lane? Rosemary from Hong Kong Phooey? The mother from Timo Supremo? Jasmine is also pretty picky when it comes to fighting the suitor. Again, you can't blame her. We're talking about someone who will become the Sultan. That's a pretty big deal, especially for someone looking for the fast route for fame and fortune. And that's exactly a major turnoff for Jasmine. She knows they don't want to marry her for her. They want her for the power and riches. Jasmine, on the other hand...
Father, I hate being forced into this. If I do marry, I want it to be for love.
So, to recap, she openly refuses to marry without love, tells her father she thinks the laws of Agrabah is wrong, runs away rather than compromise her beliefs, and pledges to use her power to rid corruption from the kingdom, whether it be Jafar or some unloyal prince. Talk about an empowered princess. Yeah, we always like to look at Jasmine in her pretty dresses and gowns, but we do tend to forget that she is one of Disney's baddest and most fierce princesses who doesn't wait for no man and goes on adventures as she states in the sequel.
I'm going to see the world too.
She even has a lot of epic moments in the television series, like taking on Mosinrath.
Next time, know who you're up against.
Speaking of which, much like Aladdin, the TV series does explore more of Jasmine's character. She even has several episodes focused on her wits, skills, and loving heart. For example, in the episode Garden of Evil, she tries to explain to Arbutus how not all humans are wicked and that some do have an appreciation for nature. In the end, Jasmine is a fine young woman who breaks the Disney princess boundaries, and her and Aladdin make one of Disney's finest couples. And once again, this is further shown in the series. There will be times when they have obstacles to go through, such as other romantic rivals like Sadir and Selene. There are even times when the two get into fights, where Jasmine gets mad over Aladdin's ego, and Aladdin gets mad at her stubbornness. However, the two have proven again and again that they do love each other, and their love is shown the strongest in the episode Eye of the Beholder. Here, Mirage turns Jasmine into a humanoid snake to test Aladdin if he truly loves her, even if she becomes a hideous creature. Aladdin was willing to sacrifice his own humanity just so he can be with her, proving to Mirage that he does care about her, whether as a human or a serpent. There was also the time Jasmine stood up for Aladdin against some really stubborn ambassadors in the episode Riders Redux. And while Aladdin and the King of Thieves may have been the finale to the Aladdin franchise, it wouldn't be the last time we see these two lovebirds. They would appear in an episode of the Hercules animated series, Hercules and the Arabian Nights, make small appearances in House of Mouse, have roles in Kingdom Hearts, Jasmine herself would appear in Enchanted Tales, Follow Your Dreams, and Sophia the First, and just recently appear in the 6th season of Once Upon a Time. Oh, and just on a side note, two of these appearances would have Jasmine and Ariel interact. Now we just have to wait and see what the live-action remake will have in store. Overall, Aladdin and Jasmine make a great couple who originally came from two different worlds. One came from a life without comfort, and the other came from a life without freedom. But once the two came together, they free each other from their miseries and show each other, well, as they put it, was Aladdin and Jasmine from Disney's Aladdin. I hope you all enjoyed this really extensive episode of Hall of Heroes, and I'm not exactly sure who I'm going to do for the next episode, but with Halloween around the corner, that gives me some ideas. But until then, this is CK Brown 7 signing out. See y'all next time.